benefit of those who were not here yesterday, we traced the origin of nations out of Genesis, descendant from the three sons of Noah, and that the nations are exhibited in rebellion from the very inception, and the dispersal of the nations is already a judgment. So the thought that occurs to me is that nations are still in the place of exile or judgment or dispersion, going all the way back to the initial calamity of the Tower of Babel and the exaltation of men above God, and that the Lord's answer is one man out from a nation, a Semitic nation that has lost the knowledge of God and has itself descended into idolatry. And that man is Abram, who becomes Abraham, the father of many nations. Notice how the word nation is just continually reiterated. I think Romans 4 speaks of Abraham as the heir of nations, or the heir of all nations. Am I right in that? Somebody can find that verse in Romans chapter 4. So the issue of nations is struck from the very beginning. Of course, none of them have any consciousness of that origin or of their condition. And the end of God's redemptive work is to bring the nations into alignment with himself and under his sovereignty and his rule, seeing that he is the creator. And the instrument is Abraham, the father of a nation, and that nation is Israel, the covenant nation. But Israel is not the end in itself, but a means to a greater and larger end, the restoration of all nations through the restoration of itself. Therefore, Satan, knowing and understanding better than the church the redemptive intention of God, will seek to destroy the means by which the redemption of nations is to be obtained, which is to say, the loss of the powers of darkness in their false, usurping governmental role over nations, is the issue of Israel in its right role as the center of God's theocratic rule, that out of Zion must go forth the law, and out of Jerusalem the word of the Lord to all nations. Have I said too much too soon? I'm beside myself. We'll go over this many times. Unless the church understands the construct, the setting, the theocratic format of which it is the central agency toward Israel, that Israel might be the agency toward the nations, the church itself doesn't have an awareness of its own identity. Its function will be therefore warped. Its sense of itself, its purpose, will suffer loss, because does not rightly see itself in this entire governmental and theocratic context. And that, in fact, is the condition of the church today. The church does not perceive itself rightly, does not see itself in this context. It has lost the entire context of the kingdom. And the word kingdom has itself suffered great loss and has come to mean something much less than God's intention. Namely, the kingdom of God is within, some kind of subjective, personal, experiential kind of a thing, or a kind of mode of conduct or ethical, moral mode of being that has lost the theocratic sense of the kingdom. Kratic is the Greek suffix that means rule. Democratic, democracy, is the rule of people. Theo is God. Theocracy is the rule of God. So we need to know, resuscitate, restore, and make alive again this central theme of God's whole redemptive working. And the Germans had the word for it, they always do. We would never have come up with it. Heilsgeschichte, salvation history. They see the great sweep of God, the whole theme of God. That we have lost this, and especially in Western Christianity, and especially of the West, the United States or America, the whole of the faith has been reduced to a totally individualistic going to heaven after you die, being saved for yourself out of sin and death, giving some nominal condescension to others who have also experienced salvation by attending services with them. Mm. We've lost the whole genius, the whole great cosmic sense of redemption that makes our own salvation significant and the church itself brought into proper recognition as worthy of all of our devotion, for it is the means of toward God's ultimate end, which is His glory. Mm-hmm. That, it all began with one man, Abraham. Chapter 12 follows chapter 11 in Genesis. Chapter 11 is the dispersal of the nations, the confusing of their tongues, lest in this false ecumenical, political, and religious unity, they would have done greater damage than just a power. We need to contemplate that for just a moment, because the warp of this intention of God to Abraham and his descendants, Israel, has given rise to a whole unregenerate sense of Israel as being in a conspiracy to obtain the world. Mm-hmm. The Protocols of Zion, you know, this piece of fiction, this anti-Semitic literature that has swept the world now for a century, indicates a design of Jews to take over the world, a conspiracy, a Zionist conspiracy. That is very alive and just under the surface of the Gentile nations. And what I believe it is a warp of this divine intention. That Abraham and his descendants should be the heir of the world, not to take it over. See, that's the way the unregenerate mind would conceive it and fuel their anti-Semitic hatred, which is out of the bowels of hell, which finally we're going to see in our generation expressed as a uncompromising and bitter attempt to annihilate Jews, lest they succeed in what the unregenerate world fears as a takeover. But this is not a takeover, this is an heir. This is to inherit. It's interesting, it's the same word that God uses for Israel when He will restore them to the land and they will inherit the land. The word inherit is so much more gracious than grasping. It's something given that you obtain by virtue of relationship. In father-son covenant by which you obtained an inheritance. Abraham is the heir of the world, not a heavy-handed usurper. Mm-hmm. On the contrary, the devil is the usurper. He is seeking and loves to have political sway over the nations and has it to this day and to this hour and has affected the world in this false usurping role. And we'll get into this about the powers of the air. Not only do we have a fallen mankind on the earth that are conspiring against God to be more exalted or higher than the Most High, but we have in the heavens a comparable rebellion. In fact, their rebellion is a reflection of the one already taking place with the anointed cherub, the prince, who wants to exalt himself above God and inspires men with that same subversive intention. So we have to see the whole of the drama in this context of rebellion against God being expressed in nations that God has to divide and separate, lest in their false unity they would succeed in their mischief. I'm reading from a famous Hebrew Christian commentator, Delitzsch, D-E-L-I-T-Z-S-H, a German Hebrew Christian of the 19th century. I have two of his books here this morning. And here's the way he sums up what we're discussing. That the eternal root of corruption had not been destroyed through the flood, and still is communicated through the Noah's descendants, and was carried out in Shinar. I'm interested to learn that the Akkadian word is Sumer, S-U-M-I-R, like Sumeria. That place in the Middle East, by the river Euphrates, where we, as we read yesterday, they were wandering in the east and settled on that plain. And that this was the beginning of nationalities, when the Lord confounded their language, and the beginning of religions, because each of these nations has a distinctive culture and a religious expression. And that God's answer to this should take place within the line of Shem. And Shem is, from this time on, the center point of the history of salvation. The line of the covenant goes through Shem. And we read that great statement that is full of portent, that Japheth shall be enlarged, but he must dwell in the tent of Shem. We're still waiting for that. And part of the evil of our world and of the 20th century are the Japheth nations, European, who have not condescended to enter, let alone dwell in the tent of Shem, and therefore bring all of their expansiveness and its aggressiveness into the world as imperialism, violence, war, and all the other covenants here. They have lost the tempering benefit that would have come to Japheth had he condescended to bow and to enter and to dwell in the tent of Shem. Shem brings something. There's a dimension, a quotient of God that is uniquely given Shem, the Semitic dimension. What that Paul can say about those that are grafted back into their own tree, how much more, Paul's favorite phrase, how much more when they are grafted back into their own tree, how much more will they explicate, demonstrate, and give to the world the benefit of that unique thing that God has invested in this line of Shem. Japheth has his distinction, Ham has his distinction, but the line of redemption is Shem. And the greatest Semite of all is none other than Jesus himself. Mm-hmm. And when the nations will come into his tent, mm-hmm. at the end of the age, mm-hmm. they will be in the redemptive, tempering place of God. And then we will see a harmony between all of the sons of Noah and their descendants in the configuration of God's intention for the peopling of this planet Earth. Mm-hmm. Got the idea? Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, I'd like to look today at Psalm 22, which is one of the great psalms of crucifixion, maybe the most bitter, the most despondent. It begins with the great cry, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Because in that psalm that begins as despondently as that, maybe the heart of the suffering of Jesus at the cross, however cruel and agonizing the physical pain, was the sense of the absence of his Father's presence. Why have you forsaken me? So there's no way to assess what that meant for him. But the remarkable thing is that before that psalm ends, there's a statement of this crucified one that speaks of a final and last day's redemption that is set in motion by this very forsakenness and this very crucifixion that has to do with God's rule in creation. It's a very brief statement, but I think that we need to consider it, and to consider that it was in the heart of Jesus when he cried out from Psalm 22, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? He knew that that quotation came from the same Psalm of David It has to do with a statement in verse 27 about God's ultimate intention for all creation. I'm going to say this in one way or another several times over, but it's this knowledge, this eschatological knowledge of that Jesus knew that when he said it is finished, he was conscious that what was finished is God's act of redemption through his suffering unto death that would regain for him the nations and establish his sovereignty and rule over all the earth.
Amen.
If he did not know that, he would have died in a kind of desolate forsakenness. And that this is enormously significant, because the Lord is in his own suffering and death giving us a basis for encouragement and strength when the day comes and we will have to cry out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that an interesting alternative and contradiction to the present theme in our charismatic circles about the presence of God, the presence of God, the presence of God, the presence of God, as if the presence of God is all, and that's the thing to be sought. And I don't want to diminish or minimize how precious a thing the presence of God is, but it's almost reaching the proportions of a fetish, as if it's magical that the presence of God is some kind of rubbing the genie lamp. And yet when we consider the sufferings of the Lord, which are a paradigm or pattern of our own at the end of the age, it's not the presence of God that he enjoys, but the forsakenness of God which he has to bear. This is not accident. This is pattern, and it will be our experience. Therefore, it's critical for us to understand what sustained the Lord in the ultimate final expression of the agony that he had to bear in the sense of God's forsakenness. And I believe that what sustained him is what we're now going to consider in this brief statement in the same psalm that begins with, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? But includes in verse 27, all the ends of the earth shall remember and return to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. I stumbled on that by accident. I was totally preoccupied with the early part of the psalm because of the agony of the cross, and only just in reading through did I stumble upon this and think, wow, what a strange inclusion. How does that have any part in the experience of this forsakenness that it should be included? But it has everything to commend it. And I tried to suggest this on a one-day visit to Indonesia, where Islamic persecution is rabid. It has not yet reached the city of Jakarta, where I was speaking, the capital, but it will. So the Lord was speaking something to the saints of Indonesia to put some iron in their soul for a persecution which I believe must come. And I quoted this psalm and gave this example out of the Lord's experience, that the church, to stand in the time of last day's persecution, must have as firm a grasp and an anticipation of the eschatological climax of the faith as Jesus himself had, and as was breathed by the Spirit into the psalm of David, so that the Jesus who spoke from that psalm also was at the same time indicating the reference to this content. He believed that by his death this was going to be fulfilled, that the nations that have forgotten God will remember and return and worship. So just the language of this, that the nations will remember, indicates that they have forgotten. So to forget God is endemic in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Even in those nations that begin their sessions of Congress with prayer, or swear in their public offices by having their hands on the Bible, the world, even the Christian world, has essentially forsaken God or forgotten him. And yet the end of the matter is that they will remember and return and worship. Worship doesn't mean only to celebrate God in choruses. Worship means to serve, because you acknowledge Him in His sovereign and right rule over yourself and over the nations.
Are you guys following me?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. This is why I was looking for an out. Because isn't it remarkable that even to take up these themes is ourselves and myself to experience a certain measure of God-forsakenness, as if we're alone in trying to communicate this remarkable theme and having in some measure to experience the mystery of what was wrought at the cross in order to resuscitate or to discover and restore this eschatological element that is in the same psalm. And I believe it's in there by divine wisdom. It belongs there. And I'll say it again and again. I believe it sustained the Lord, and it must necessarily sustain us, that our future sufferings can be borne because we know that it's part and parcel of the whole redemptive program of God by which the nations shall be brought to remember the God whom they have forgotten, and to be return and to worship Him, so that all nations, all the earth, will give praise to the God of Jacob. We've got to understand the remarkable enterprise of God. The earth is the Lord's, and the nations and those that dwell therein, though they do not know it and don't even want to be informed about it, for they want their own autonomy, self-rule, and to do their own thing, as if their nation and its geographical territory is their baby to do with what they will, their playground. They don't want to know that there's a God who's a creator, and that He's a purposeful creator, and that He's established the parameters and the bounds of the nations so that they might seek Him, not just for their salvation, but for the purpose for which He has created them as nations. Nations do not want to know that God has a purpose, because clearly it's going to be in contradiction with their own. The nations want to do their own thing. And there's a power of darkness that aids and abets this very impulse and desire. And maybe we'll come back to Psalm 22, return to Psalm 2, where we see the naked revelation and statement of the enmity of the nations against God. And however cloaked that might be, however polite the nations might be in their deference to God, that is expedient for them, the truth of the matter is that when that veil is removed, as it will be in the last days and is already being removed, we're going to see this naked, fierce enmity against God. So, why do the nations rage? Is that the word you have in your Bible?
Heathen.
The heathen.
Conspire.
Okay, heathen, goyim, nations, all refer to the same thing. Any nation other than Israel are the nations, the heathen, and the goyim. They are unredeemed. I'm quoting, or I'm paraphrasing Paul in Acts 17 in his address at Mars Hill, which clever theologians refer to as Paul's failure. Paul failed to establish a church in Athens. He didn't bring the gospel. He spoke instead a strange message about the issue of nations, and said to these men who seemed to condescend to God by their monuments to the unknown God, that Him whom you worship ignorantly, I declare unto you. Then he begins. Shall we look at that? Acts 17? And then bring us back to Psalm 2 and then to Psalm 22. This is the creative thing that I was referring to in my prayer, what the Lord will do on the spot. So the fact that all of this took place in Athens is not coincidental, but enormously significant. Yeah. This is the only statement that Paul makes in his entire apostolic career that's recorded that addresses the subject of nations, God's intention for the earth, and he's speaking it to the supreme civilization of his own generation. The glory that was Greece. Anyone who's ever been to Mars Hill now, and I've been there several times, knows that the stone that legend says upon which Paul stood and spoke is so smooth by the passage of feet that you can't stand on it, you'll slip off. But when you stand at that location and look up, you see the temples that surround this elevation that have been destroyed in history. And they're only fragments of what was in Paul's generation complete and entire. And that's why the phrase, the glory that was Greece, was universal. Greece was the epitome of human civilization. It's the epitome of humanism. It celebrates man. It celebrates philosophy. The Renaissance in European history is nothing other but the restoration of bringing back again into the consciousness of Europeans the genius of the civilization that was Greece. Rome was only a pale counterfeit. Rome took the Greek contribution, what shall I say, commercialized it, employed it. There were the practical road builders and so on and so on, state craftsmen. But the genius of Greece is its humanism, the celebration of man, the same kind of exaltation of man that we saw in Genesis 10 and 11. So Paul speaking at Mars Hill to Athens, to the philosophers, to say the cream of society, the men who really influence their age, has got to be the most significant setting that God himself could give. And that Paul got there by accident. He was in flight from persecution and was brought there by others. It has nothing to do with his own volition, but that the Lord himself so structured his days as to bring him there. And so while he was waiting for his colleagues to catch up with him, it says that he grieved as he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. Imagine the sensitivity of this apostolic heart. For what is humanism but idolatry? And what are the temples to goddesses and other supposed deities but the celebration of man in a transported form? He saw right through it, and maybe that's the heart of what is apostolic, is the ability to perceive and to see through the appearance of things and to recognize what it in fact is: rebellion against God. Mm-hmm. Idolatry is rebellion against God. Mm-hmm. Maybe ultimate is idolatry is the employment of God, where we can make our phraseologies or religious practices idolatrous and God replacing or God substituting. Idolatry is that basic disposition of man and the celebration of himself against God. Paul grieved when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. Isn't it interesting what subsequent civilizations have celebrated Paul saw through as idolatry? You can't understand Nazism, German Romanticism, without understanding Greece. In a perverted way, Nietzsche, the celebration of man, Superman, is a reaching back into the Greco past to restore and to establish in modern times the celebration of man. You know the statues of the discus thrower, the naked athletes, wrestling. Man is the measure of all things. And what the Nazis despised was a Christianity that had Hebraic roots, that celebrated man in his humility, in his brokenness, in his weakness, and trust and confidence in God. they saw that as man denying and wanted to edit Christianity to make it compatible to German civilization. When you see the great Nazi celebrations, torchlight parades, the arm of men, force, mass, power, you see that the ideal that goes back to Greece was a phenomenal factor in the whole advent of Nazism, and that Jews were its victims, even in their unbelief, even in their apostasy, is therefore very fitting and appropriate. Well, the Jews were hated not so much for the live quality of their faith, but even in their apostasy and even in their desire to be accommodated into German civilization, they were still the representatives of a God of Israel whose mode and mind is totally in opposition to that which is Greek. It's not an accident that as an atheist and as a history teacher, I had up at the front of my history room the sign, "Go Greek." And how did I get saved? On my way to Greece. On a tramp steamer, a Greek tramp steamer, as the cheapest transportation, as a deck passenger, a Jewish fellow passenger had a copy of the pocket New Testament. And aboard the deck of that ship, out of the light coming from the portholes where the well-paying passengers were living out, I was reading a Greek book about a Semite, the ultimate Semite, Jesus of Nazareth. Isn't that remarkable? And one statement out of a Semitic mouth, the revelation of God came to turn this Jew, who is more a Greek than a Hebrew, into my ancestral identity, which is your privilege also as the sons and daughters of Abraham. So Paul in Acts 17, grieved by the idolatry which he saw. The next verse says in verse 17 of chapter 17, "Therefore disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons, and in the market daily with them that met with him." What a remarkable statement. And it goes from idolatry to the synagogue to devout persons to the marketplace. For all of those places are reeking with idolatry, even whether they're religious or secular. The synagogue is a place of idolatry and God substitution, even in the employment of Old Testament usage. See me? That's why he disputed and debated both with the Jews and with the devout persons and in the marketplace. The marketplace is ultimate idolatry, now as then. So, and then they heard him, this babbler. What will this babbler say? Because he speaks of strange gods, preached to them Jesus and the resurrection. I love that. Because though he knows they are utterly secular and humanistic, he does not in any way feel embarrassed to bring a religious item to their consideration, Jesus and the resurrection. Because the issue of Jesus and the resurrection is not a religious item. It is ultimate truth, pervasive, for all the world and for all creation. This is God's act. Jesus and the resurrection is setting in motion God's redemptive action for the regaining of the nations, including Greece. And it is totally appropriate. It's not inappropriate because it's religious and secular. These are categories that are not of God. Understand? He was not embarrassed to bring the truth of God to secular consideration, and that's where it needs to be brought. However much they would consider it babbling. And so they brought him up to Mars Hill, and Paul stood in verse 22 in the midst of it and said, "You men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you're too superstitious." He could not have chosen a worse beginning than to offend intellectuals and to tell them that they're superstitious. But that in fact is what they were. You know, this is a real glimpse of apostolic genius itself. The grieving at idolatry, the debating in the synagogue and the marketplace, and then beginning in the most, what shall I say, indecorous the least likely way to begin if you want to win the attention of your audience is to begin with an insult in the very thing in which they pride themselves. The last thing that an intellectual will consider himself to be is superstitious. He thinks that he is elevated out from superstition by virtue of his philosophy and his intellectualizing. But Paul sees, no, that even that itself is a superstition. And he names it. So we have here apostolic seeing, apostolic clarity, apostolic boldness. It's a wonderful portrait. What makes it all the more powerful is that it is totally unselfconscious. He's not doing step one, step two, step three to give us a textbook. He's simply being what he is in God. And in that, we have the most remarkable statement of what the genius of apostolicity itself is. Because this is not just an episode out of history. This is a foreshadowing of something future. Amen. We can almost say that the last days will be a reiteration of the challenge of the nations at Mars Hill by apostolic men who are sent in the boldness of God to identify idolatry and perversion and God indifference and to call them to the knowledge of the true God. What Paul is stating here is a picture of our own call at some future time. So let's get to the here he makes mention to the unknown God that they have used in an ostentatious way as if it's spiritual, but it's a willful ignorance. They choose to have God as unknown because an unknown God makes no requirements and gives the air of spirituality. Oh, how nice. Oh, how sensitive you are to the unknown God. How respectful. But Paul sees right through this counterfeit, and he's not going to let them get away with it. This God whom you ignorantly worship, which is a willful ignorance, declare I unto you. Is this arrogance? Is this conceit? Should he be more deferring, more self-effacing, more humble? The boldness of Paul is astonishing. Because when you talk to men like this, who think that they are hotshots and have it all together and are the supreme leaders of their society, they're not going to just pat you on the back and send you away. They're liable to kill you for words as offensive as this. So we need to know that this kind of declaration comes at risk, and Paul was willing to make it. This was not some prepared statement that he had in his briefcase for all occasions. This is what was given him on the spot by God, by the Spirit, in this remarkably significant once and for all occasion, not to be given again and not anywhere repeated in the whole of Paul's apostolic career. That's why it deserves from us an uttermost attention. And then he goes on, God that made the world. Isn't it an interesting place to begin? God that made the world. Mm-hmm. What is more under attack today than who made the world? If the world is itself only a kind of geophysical freak accident, then nothing can be ascribed to it. No purpose can be understood for it. It's whatever you choose to give it. But if there's a God who created it, then of necessity it follows that he creates with purpose. He creates with intention. Therefore, we are under an obligation who are abiding on the world that he made and the nations that he established to discover that purpose and to fulfill it. That's why men prefer to have God ignorantly, as unknown. They don't want the revelation of his purpose. And what nation today most exemplifies this mentality?
Israel.
Of all of the ironic things that nation selected and chosen to bring nations under the purview of God, itself is not under that authority, nor does not desire it, and does not want to discover or know what God's purpose for that nation is. They have their own. They want to be, as I mentioned yesterday many times, the Hong Kong of the Middle East. They want to sell Gucci leather goods and succeed in the high-tech civilization that they have already become. So, how is God going to make it? how is he going to succeed with the people who don't even want to learn of their calling, let alone fulfill it? And of course, if he fails, how then can he be, how then is he God? The whole issue of God is succeeding in the gifts and callings that he himself has given, mm-hmm. and of those, and that one whom he has chosen. See what I mean? And if Satan shall succeed in preventing this, then God is diminished. So in the last analysis, the issue of Israel is God. And that's why the contest is going to be so fierce. And that's why when we go back to Psalm 2, we will understand that it begins with, look how the heathen rage. The unregenerate nations rage. We talk now about road rage. All kinds of rage now is becoming current in our frenetic civilization. Rage is ultimate emotion. Maybe somebody has a better word for it. Well, this is a new phenomenon in our generation. Men actually shooting at other cars and drivers.
Yeah.
Because they're going too slow, or they're hogging the passing lane, or some other affront. And men fly into a rage. I think there are little things that you can put your keys on now that have a button like a machine gun. And so to ventilate this rage, you can press that, and some imaginary way you're blowing the offending driver off the road. Rage is becoming characteristic of our generation. What are the days called now that has broken out in the Second Intifada that is now threatening Israel's very life?
Days of rage.
The days of rage. So rage is an ultimate emotion of such intensity that will not be satisfied with anything less than the death of that which offends it. And that rage is going to pursue Jews in the time of Jacob's trouble through all nations, and is already afflicting them in the nation. So Psalm 2 is prophetic, and what's the word speaks of the last days things?
Eschatological.
We'll come back to it in a moment. So, God that made the world and all things therein. I love the way Paul begins. That's the way to begin. Let's get something straight. God is the creator. That's foundational fact. And he's created all things. And what's the implication? That includes Greece and Athens. Don't think that you're an accident. There's a God who has created all things, and you need to know that. So he's starting with the most fundamental fact, and then he draws out the implications. He's the Lord of heaven and earth that is so all-inclusive, there's nothing that can be omitted. The creator of all and the Lord of all. He's Lord because he's creator. He has the right to have dominion over the earth because he has created it. This is the legal sanction and justification for his rulership, is that he's the creator. Therefore, the whole of that which is opposed to God is trying to break down the issue of God as creator. If you can ruin that, if you can defy that, if you can dissolve that, then the whole issue of lordship goes with it. What does it say? We are not our own.
Right.
We are bought with a price. Amen. We have not made ourselves. He has made us. We're his. Amen. So he's Lord over ourselves as he's Lord over the earth. So just look at the logic of Paul's apostolic thought. All nations of men to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation. You know, when Jesus sent out the 70, the commentators say that the number 70 was not some impulse of the moment, but rather what was understood Hebraically as being the number of nations that God has created. Seven, of course, is the number of completion. It's a multiple of seven. But how many nations do we have today? 250, 60, I don't know. They're continuing to multiply. The Croatians want their own, and the Serbians want their own, and who are the others?
Albanians
want their own. This whole fragmentation at the heart of Europe is over a nationalistic impulse to to have your own nationhood, your own language, your own culture, as distinct from that of your neighbor. And so they continue to fragment and to multiply. And I'm suggesting also that when the smoke clears, and God will have his redemptive purposes in all the earth, we're not going to see 280 nations. I think we're going to see what God intended at the first. And it may well be that all Slavic groups will be a Slavic nationhood. I don't know how God is going to do it. But the very multiplication is the continuation of the rebellion of man in his own autonomy, wanting to do his own thing, not recognizing the God that Paul is setting forth before the Greeks and telling them that your Greece is not a geophysical accident and you haven't established its boundaries. It is God who has appointed both the time and the boundaries of men. Mm-hmm. We need to understand that as the church. It's interesting. What are one of the signs of the last days even spoken by Daniel? Not only that knowledge would increase, but that transiency would increase. Men would be in motion, going from place to place, movement. All you need to do is go to any airport today. It's staggering. I look at, what are you guys doing here? I'm the only one who has real business. What's your justification? And so we see this increase. And we just look at our own histories. How many places have we lived? And some of the people in some of this room who have come from other countries. But it's interesting that when the last day's judgment of God falls and the woes begin to be poured out upon the earth, men flee back and into their own countries. I think someone can find the scripture of that kind. But God has established the balance of the sea and of the ocean. The psalmist speaks of it, that we have to respect and esteem restriction. And the impulse of modern men is to be free of all restriction. And Psalm 2 speaks of it. Let us break their cords asunder. We don't want to be imprisoned and limited by this God and his rule. We want to do our thing. Feminism is this very spirit. So, what is a saint? One who just does not tolerate the restrictive requirement of God, but rejoices in it and finds in the narrow place of contraction the prospect of true expansiveness. Just the opposite of the world's mentality. Now I'll give you a little inkling into what is prophetic for some of you who believe you have that call. I've already spoken about Paul exhibiting unconsciously, unself-consciously, the intrinsic elements of what is apostolic. Now I'll give you a little instance of what is prophetic. I was preaching from this very text. As Paul significantly spoke it in Athens, I was preaching it significantly in Nuremberg, Germany. Why is Nuremberg, Germany significant? Because that was the religious capital of Nazism. Berlin was the legal and the organizational, what do you call it, the managerial heart of Germany. But Nuremberg, because of its pagan past, was the place that Hitler used for his greatest demonstrations of torchlight parades and mass meetings and all of these kinds of things. I'm in the city of Nuremberg, and the spirits that were moved in that city from its ancient past and through the Hitler time still reside in the air above us. I'm preaching this text. I had always preached it that and God has made of one blood all men, nations of men, and given us that we might seek after him. And I thought, yes, to seek after him for salvation within the nation. But a light bulb went on in a moment of time, and all of a sudden I saw that what God was after and what he's referring to is not so much the issue of individual salvation, that if we seek after him we may be found of him, but that the nations themselves have an obligation to seek after him. And for what reason? So as to understand the purpose for their parameters, the purpose for their boundaries, the purpose for their establishment as a nation. I'm speaking to Germans, and I'm saying to them, has Germany as a nation ever sought to understand from God what is the purpose for his intention for it as a nation? Rather, on the contrary, Germany has taken to itself its own purposes and does to this day. They are imperialistic, they are commercial, they are military, they have to do with power, prestige, pomp, but not with God. And what has been the result of Germany's, and we can say for all nations that have not sought God and have invoked their own purpose? Violence, war, death, and ruin, including the death and the devastation of European Jewry. Well, if Germany was amiss then and not seeking God, what might have been God's intention for it? What is God's intention for particular nations, seeing that He's given to them a climate, a disposition, a racial, ethnic makeup? Does He have a unique purpose? And will those purposes be fulfilled in what we call the millennium? And the earth will abound and rejoice, and the earth will flower, and everyone will be in the purpose of God, fructifying and bringing the benevolent, the benefit to each other, rather than contention, strife, enmity, war, and death. We've paid a price for the nations failing to seek God for the purpose of their own nationhood. And I believe that God has that. Why do you say that? Because He's not a mindless, aimless creator. This is not a piece of blob that He has set in motion. It's one of the most intricate marvels that this planet should be sustained and have motion and belts of climate that are conducive to growth of vegetation, supportive of animal life. In fact, in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 10, Paul has the audacity to say that God has created all things in order that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God might be demonstrated in the principalities of power here. Mm-hmm. God is saying that this whole cosmic glory, this whole thing that is somehow sustained in space and is supportive of life, is for the church. Mm-hmm. All you dear saints, we have been sold a bill of goods. We are brainwashed. We have been taken into another spirit, another mentality that has completely dismissed God from its consideration. And part of the prophetic task, if not the heart of it, is to bring and restore the church itself first to the consciousness that is biblical, and then to bring that to the unsuspecting secular world, as Paul did at Athens, knowing that we'll ever get our heads chewed off, and that every power of hell will rage against us who want to continue their usurping misuse of the earth. But I would say that we're as much subject to a misuse, certainly we can see that in modern times, of our bounds and habitation as every other nation. And just as godless, maybe worse and more to be condemned, because we use the language of Christianity and make some shallow acknowledgement. But in fact, we are just as self-seeking, just as usurping of our own land. And in fact, one of the great threats is to the land itself, to the exploitation of the earth, to the misuse of the earth, that has spurred a whole movement of consciousness about preserving the planet. And in fact, there's a place where God says about that He will destroy them who destroy the earth. So it's in process of being destroyed by the greed, the avarice, the lust for power, for wealth, that men employ and have no regard that this God who created may have a purpose other than their wealth.
Deuteronomy 32, verse 8, when the Most High divided to the nations their inheritance, when He separated the sons of Adam, He set the bounds of the people according to the number of the children of Israel. For the Lord's portion is His people, Jacob, is the lot of the inheritance.
That's a remarkable, pivotal verse. And in 37 years as a believer, I've never heard anyone ever speak from it or preach from it or teach it. It's virtually lost to the church. How many times must God mention something in order to validate it as truth? I think in Habakkuk it says only one place, the just shall live by their faith. God doesn't have to repeat Himself. This is a remarkable statement that shows the centrality of Israel relative to the nations, that even the number of the nations is determined in proportion to the number of the sons of Israel. Whatever that means, there's a reciprocal connectedness between Israel and nations. And what are the nations, as we'll see in Psalm 2, wanting to do? They're wanting to throw over this very design of God and live independent of that relatedness to Israel. And it's for that reason, instinctively, must be a component of what we call anti-Semitism. The hatred of the Jew must be, in some measure, the unregenerate, unconscious anger at God's design for them relative to Israel and to the Jew. They want to spit out their guts. They don't want to be submitted to this confining thing, and especially to a people who would have been the least of those whom they would have chosen. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And how about Germans? Are Germans going to submit to Israel, to Jewry, this despised people, this proud nation? If anybody has ever been to Berlin recently, as I have, and see the area that has been marked out for the building of the new government buildings as they have moved from Bonn, B-O-N-N, on the Rhine River, which is a sleepy, pristine, beautiful little town celebrated in German poetry, but with the rejoining of East and West Germany together, they have gone back to Berlin. And the first thing they did was to put a new dome at the cost of many millions over the original Reichstag building. And then the whole area, someone counted 500 derricks. What do you call these cranes? Five in a space of, I don't know how many, a dozen football fields, all busy at one time setting up these buildings. When I drove through that, I said to the brother, the German brother in the car, I'm not looking at the capital of a nation. I'm looking at a world capital. Mm-hmm. This profuse building program, this ambition, is beyond mere national intention. This is a people who still have imperial and global intentions of rule. Mm-hmm. And it's evidenced by their ambition with their buildings. Mm-hmm. Because the spirit still remains. Mm-hmm. So imagine Germany seeking the Lord and repentantly acknowledging that it had failed to do so and had embarked on purposes of its own that have resulted in two world wars and even now are a threatening, dominating power over all Europe, great influence, and that they would ask the Lord, what is your intention for us?
Yeah.
And do it. And then I said, could it be that of all the nations of the world, no nation has had a longer, more continuous and unbroken Jewish presence than your own? All the way back to the destruction of the temple in 70 AD and the casting out of the Jews into the Roman Empire, which Germany was before it became Germany, you had Jewish establishments and communities on the Rhine River, you've had rabbinical centers, you've had Jewish population in all your cities. I wonder if God's intention was that your first purpose was toward them, that you should have been a priestly nation, being Christian, and humbled yourself to come under this Jewish people in your midst and to explain to them why they are in exile and out of the land in judgment, and so instruct and inform them and reveal to them their own God, that they would have had a means by which to return to Zion so that they could have blessed all the families of the earth. When I suggested that to a German audience at Nuremberg, whew, all hell broke loose. And I went to another place near Hanover, as I mentioned yesterday, for young believers that looked to me as a father in the faith for years. I lost them in one meeting to this day because of that statement. That's how deep and intransigent is national identity, even for Christians. And when I first spoke a message on the principalities and powers of the air, it came to me in Germany. The Lord waked me early in the morning. I picked up a piece of paper and I was scribbling something, and then I found my interpreter, an educated man, and I said, look, here's what I believe God wants me to speak. Here's why Germany lost the war, intercession, powers of the air. And the guy went blank on me. I said, anything wrong? He said, Artie said, I cannot listen to this. I cannot receive this. I don't want to believe that we lost the war and that it was God's intention and that the Spirit of God was raising up intercession in Wales to affect the outcome of the war that we should lose. I'm a German, after all. It's a spirit-filled man telling me, I'm a German. Evidently, he has not come to his own right recognition of himself as an alien, stranger, and pilgrim, and sojourner in the earth. He is too identified with his own nation and cannot even translate a message that would even raise questions for that, the church of the nation, and balked, spirit-filled. Abraham, get thee out of your nation, your kindred, and your father's house, and follow me in the land that I will show you.
Yeah.
What a rip and a tear to come out of your nation and those deep identifications of which we need to be conscious. Of course, what's the end of the age? If I can take off on Reggie's statement, it's when this same people, ugly, distorted, deformed, being cast out again into the nations, pursued relentlessly unto death, will be completely disfigured and unattractive, and will present to the church of every nation and to the nations themselves what they will do with the least of these my brethren. Even to recognize them as the brethren of the Lord in their uncomely condition requires a certain identification and union with God. So it's interesting that the final separation of the nations, one by one, sheep from goats, is the issue of how you receive Jews in their uncomely condition in the last days in the nations. The nations will have a final testing with relative to the issue of Israel, now in their midst, not just in the Middle East, now in their midst, cast out and dispersed and in an uncomely condition. And the judgment and the reward of the failure to recognize or the ability to extend mercy affects the whole eternity of those who are judged by the king. That's a remarkable conclusion to the age in the nations by the issue of Israel. And I was just going to make the statement before Reggie shared that maybe we can say that anti-Semitism, the hatred of the Jew, is altogether proportionate to the attachment of one to the nation. That nationalism is very much consonant and in keeping with anti-Semitism. And in fact, if you look at the groups in America now, these militant, what do they call these guys in Idaho and other places?
They're
white supremacists. They are militia. They're militant, nationalistic, anti-Semitic groups. Intensely nationalistic. In fact, their complaint against the nation is the failure of the nation to be the nation. So there really is a tandem connection between intense nationalism and hatred of the Jew. And it may be totally instinctive, and it goes back to God's design, that though the unregenerate don't know it, their unregenerate spirits yet recoil against it, that when God established the number of the nations, he did so in relative to the number of the sons of Israel. And this, we need to understand this. This is God's wisdom and his design for the nations. And there'll be no peace in the world until the nations themselves will peaceably yield to that and come up to the one nation that God has elected on the Feast of Tabernacles and pay homage and respect to that nation. For to respect the nation that God has exalted above all nations, where he said you'll no longer be the tail but the head, is to pay homage to God who chooses. And the unwillingness of nations, look how fierce their pride is, that God has to threaten them, if you'll not come up, if you'll not honor what I have honored and what I have chosen, you'll suffer a curse. I'll deny you rain. That'll be the end of your economy if you fail to recognize what I have exalted. Because the issue of what God has chosen is the issue of God. And all the more the issue when it's a people that the world despises and would never have chosen themselves. That really brings the rubber to the road in terms of the recognition of God as God. You have to understand the whole proportion of this great drama and its final outworking in the last days. That the last judgment is how people will regard this despised people, yet unsaved, yet in their apostasy, yet in their sin, and recognize them as the brethren of the Lord. and extend to them what we would have extended to the Lord himself. In fact, their pilgrimage and their exile is another reiteration of the crucifixion of Jesus himself.
Mm-hmm.
They're being cast into, being despised,
mm-hmm.
Having no form or comeliness that any should desire them, is God in the last reiterating again his own crucifixion through a crucified nation in order to make to reveal through their suffering his own, so that kings who have not heard will understand and will turn, so that the object even of Israel's final judgment in the world is God's salvific intent for the nations. Just hold steady, and I'll just read from Isaiah 52 what I believe confirms this view. And its future. That Israel will serve something even in their own ignorance and their own apostasy, but the attention of it is for the nations. Behold, my servant shall deal prudently, in verse 13 of Isaiah 52, shall be exalted, extolled, and be very high. That surely is the statement of Jesus, but Israel is also called to be a servant people, and in fact they will be serving God even in their ignorance, and they will be exalted. But first, many will be astonished at them. Their visage will be marred more than any man. See what I'm doing? I'm taking the statements that describe the suffering of Jesus to make it descriptive of the sufferings of Israel in the last days, and his form more than the sons of man. So shall they sprinkle many nations. The king shall shut their mouths at them, for that which had not been told them shall they see, and that which they had not heard shall they consider. For those nations who have not heard, have not considered, or have sentimentalized the cross and have lost its meaning, will have enacted before them that same drama of redemptive suffering now by the servant nation as it was formerly exhibited by the servant son. And what is the purpose of it? That they might believe and be turned and worship the Lord. Israel is his witness. I just read recently a comment of why it is that Jesus upset the money changers' tables and never once actually confronted the defunct temple worship being performed by an apostate priesthood. Instead, he ventilated his anger on the money changers' tables, because that took place in the courtyard of the Gentiles. And he said in his outrage, you have made of my father's house a place of business, and this house is a place of prayer for all nations. So that what Jesus was really saying is that you, apostate Israel, have failed in the purpose for which you were appointed. Not for yourself. Your worship and sacrifices are not for yourself to be consumed upon your own religious lust, but your purpose is for all nations. My house is to be a house of prayer for all nations, and you have made it a den of thieves, and this I cannot bear and tolerate, and this I overthrow. And so his anger was out of the same consciousness of Israel's ultimate purpose, which is the redemption of nations. And they had failed in that and turned it into commerce and into business. So how deep is the consciousness of Jesus of what is Israel's real calling? Because he is the ultimate Semite. Who should know it? And who has suffered more for the fulfillment of it? And that's why in Psalm 22, in the greatest statement of the suffering of Jesus, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? In that very psalm is the statement that all the nations who have forgotten will remember and return and worship the Lord. That the nations will be his. That in the consciousness of this ultimate Semite is the deep eschatological awareness of the purpose of God for Israel to the nations. And we need to see that, and we need to understand it, or we will be offended by the last day's dealings of God with that nation. And we will. How has God allowed them yet again to face another Holocaust if we don't understand what their destiny is? Yes, they will be diminished. They will be abated. They will be brought down even unto death.
Yeah.
They will reenact the crucifixion of their Lord before them. They will be a crucified nation. But as the Lord exalted the Son and gave him the name above every name, because he was obedient unto death, so will he take Israel, who will suffer unto death, and exalt them and give them a name above all nations, that all nations will flow to Jerusalem, and the Lord will go forth from Zion, the word of war from Jerusalem, and he will judge many peoples and decide for many nations. They will beat their swords into plowshares and so on, and all nations will not learn war again. They will come up to Zion to learn the ways of the God of Jacob.
Mm-hmm.
When you read Isaiah 53 very carefully,
mm-hmm.
there's a change in voice. Maybe I'll just share that with you now. Verse 4, or even verse 3, he is despised and rejected, and a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and we, as it were, hid our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Who's saying that? Who's coming to this recognition that they had missed the meaning and the significance of the suffering of Jesus at Calvary? Who's the we? Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem or prefer him stricken and smitten of God and afflicted, but he was wounded for our transgressions. So I'm saying, I'm not doing this justice, but we need to see the shift in voice and who's speaking, because it begins with a narrative and a description, and then some people who are there have come to a recognition that was not theirs before. But how did they come to it? They came to it by the mutuality of their suffering, that when they were stricken, when they had no comeliness that any should desire them, when they were despised and rejected of men, they could say, oh, now we understand why he was stricken, why he was despised, because now we're tasting, now we're experiencing, and now we realize it was for our transgressions.
Right.
It's going to take this much to bring this erring nation after 2,000 years to the depth of this recognition, for unless they come to it, how shall they bless all the families of the earth? And if God did not stop short in bringing their Lord and his Son to this suffering, shall he stop short at theirs? For they have exactly the same destiny as the tent of Shem, to which all the nations must come, not by a disfigured people, but by an exalted people who have been brought from death into life and in the character of God himself, given a new name, the priests, the ministers of God. So we can expect the crucifixion of Israel, but it's going to be enacted globally, so kings who had did not understand and did not see will, how does it say it? Shall shut their mouths at them, for that which had not been told them shall they see. How shall they see it 2,000 years after the crucifixion of Jesus, except it is demonstrated again by the nation? They shall see in the nation's strickenness what they had not observed nor understood 2,000 years before, where there has been a great loss in the significance of his suffering and death, even by the church that has sentimentalized and transfigured that suffering into some kind of soppy cross that has robbed its content. We're going to have to see it reenacted, and Israel is appointed for their own edification, but for also for kings and for nations. If we lose the context of God's intention for the nations and Israel's destiny and relatedness to the nations, we lose the whole genius of the sweep of God's whole redemptive program. And then how shall we understand ourselves as the church? Then we are condemned to mere Sunday services and to programs and to youth camps and to amusement and bowling alleys and all the kinds of things that the churches are desperately seeking for in order to hold their members, because they have never had or understood the enormous context of the faith and the remarkable transforming and uplifting inspiration that comes with that knowledge. And when we come to the subject of Japan and begin to study why it is that the Christian church in Japan failed why the Western missionaries could not take advantage of a broken, collapsed nation after World War II, whose Tokyo was in ruins and Hiroshima and Nagasaki were places of death, is because they had not a message that was more powerful than the appeal of traditional Shintoism and Buddhism. All they could offer is was a narrow, individualistic gospel of salvation by which you go to heaven, but they lost completely the component of the kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's only the kingdom that can eclipse the majestic designs that are implicit both in Shintoism and Buddhism, but especially Shintoism, because the emperor is considered to be deity. And Japan's intention in World War II was not just animal conquest or mere appropriation of land, but to bring the redemption of Japanese deification to the world. And so what message did the Western missionaries have if they had not a message of greater significance, which is the gospel of the kingdom? And why didn't they have it? Because the gospel of the kingdom is the kingdom of David. It's a Davidic kingdom. It's the kingdom promised Israel, but for all nations. And because they were isolated and separated from the Jewish component and connection, they could not proclaim it or stand for it. They had, therefore, a truncated and inadequate gospel, which is the same thing that is complained about today with the North American Indians. We had a brother in this very room who is the head of the Indian Department of the Christian Missionary Alliance Church come and share with us with his father, who's the head of the Oak Hills Bible School, their Indian department, say, on the basis of my lifelong study of why it is that North American Indians are so subject to falling back in the faith, backsliding and losing the faith, and why the church has always been minimal, and why we have the highest suicide rates, alcoholism, he says, I've come to the conclusion that the gospel that has been proclaimed to us is inadequate. It was a minimal gospel, and there was a dimension lacking, which I am assured now has everything to do with Israel and with the Jew, which is to say, the kingdom. And so it became just a kind of a personal gospel that is sufficient for middle-class people as a Sunday addendum, but was not powerful enough for a people that are ravaged by dark powers and spirits and need the full counsel of God, and did not have it because the missionaries did not have it to communicate. Can you see? We have lost something. The issue of Israel is the issue of the nations. The issue of Israel is the issue of the kingdom. It's the issue of God's sovereignty and rule over his creation. It's an enormously uplifting and significant thing. Let me read what I wrote to you that I shared with the believers in Indonesia. Note must be made of what filled Jesus' head and heart at the very time of his acute suffering, as expressed in verses 22 through 35, namely to praise him and to make his name known in the midst of the great congregation. The end of all redemptive suffering is the winning of God's creation to himself everlastingly, when all the ends of the world shall remember and turn unto the Lord, and the kindreds of the nations shall worship before thee. O you dear saints, Lord, give us grace. This has got to be ignited in our spirits. This has got to be birthed into our understanding. That's why our prayer time is so important. This is more than just teaching sessions. Something has got to come that has been lost to the consideration of the church through generations and must be restored. So what am I saying here? All the ends of the world shall remember to the Lord. All the kindreds of the nations shall worship before thee. The winning of God's creation to himself everlastingly was a note of such significance for Jesus that he could bear his sufferings on the cross, even the sense of being forsaken by his Father. That he could cry out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And yet at the same time be sustained, because he knew that the sufferings were pivotal and the key to this redemption for the nations.
Amen.
For the redemption of the nations to come under the sovereignty and rule of the God who created them is the issue of God's glory forever.
Amen.
And anything that seeks to serve God outside of that context and that understanding must necessarily be impoverished. This component must be restored. This is the, and when this gospel of the kingdom shall be proclaimed to all nations then shall the end come. What is the gospel of the kingdom to all nations? That there's not just a narrow individualistic salvation that God is making available to you, but a design for the nation itself as a nation to be redeemed to the Lord who has created it, of which your salvation is but part, and you lose the greater significance of that salvation except you see it in the context of your nation. The German friends that I lost said, well, what about the gospel part? And shouldn't we just be speaking salvation to individuals? I said, you know, I wonder if even that is inadequate unless they see their personal sins as being the sins of the nation. Maybe we missed it with Germany as we missed it with Japan by failing to identify the sins of the individual as being also the sins of their nation. For what is the sin of the nation but the composite conduct or failure of those that comprise it? Mm-hmm. And to try to say, well, you're a sinner because you drink, or you hit your wife, or you blasphemed, is that as compelling as to say, you're a sinner because you were part and sanctioned and gave yourself to an enterprise of your nation that sought to rape Nanking and destroy Singapore and despised all races and saw yourself as superior and raped and looted and pillaged the whole of Asia. And you have a responsibility because you celebrated this emperor as being God, and you chose an idol rather than the knowledge of the true God, and you gave yourself to destruction and violence and rape. And your sin is the sin of the nation. And until you're convicted of that, are you really convicted? Wow. See what I mean? So to see our sins in the context of nations, and that we're bound up with our nation and are responsible and are culpable, is maybe the most profound basis for the appeal for salvation, which is exactly the message that Peter preached at Pentecost. He accuses his hearers of being guilty of crucifying the Son of Glory, and they were not even present at his crucifixion, but he identifies them with the sin as being the sin of the nation. And he says to them, now, come out from among, come out from this untoward generation. There's a judgment about to fall on the nation, and this is the salvation that God is offering. Mm-hmm. The whole message was in the context of national guilt. Mm-hmm. And how, what modern Jew today has ever been appealed to on that basis? Mm-hmm. And that's why we are commencing a program of instruction for evangelism to Jews that is called apocalyptic evangelism, by which Jews will be instructed of these very things, and that they are under a judgment with the nation, even whether they're living in America, let alone in Israel, and that there's a salvation in Messiah, that they share not in the guilt and the judgment that is to come, and have a place of safety. So too, if Jesus' soul was filled with this eschatological understanding that enabled him to bear his ultimate suffering, so too must our own souls be filled with this eschatological hope, the very conclusion of the ages. For only a vision of this kind can absorb the pain of last day sufferings, and in fact be the very demonstration that breaks that's the straw that breaks the back of the resistance of the nations to the recognition of the God of Jacob as being the God of all the earth. Our sufferings, like his, demands this context. We have been a church without an eschatology. We have been a church without a consciousness of the end. We have not seen the great design of God, and therefore we are unfitted to suffer for that design. Jesus was able to bear on the cross what his understanding of God's undertaking for the nation meant, and we need to understand it also to bear that measure of suffering reserved for us. And this cannot be a last moment's groping, but that which has consistently been our thought, as it was his. Maybe it explains more than anything why it is that the church of modern times, the last 2 centuries and a half, has been so susceptible, conducive, a setup, you might say, for an escapist ideology of pre-tribulation rapture. Because if we have no grit by which we can stand the suffering of tribulation, then we will be candidates to look for some out that would be presented us. The final statement that I make is evidently seeing the theocratic fulfillment as evidence from the very first martyrdom of Stephen, who, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly to heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God, that is the seat of power, the throne of governmental authority of the creation. Isn't it interesting that the first martyr himself is able to abide his suffering, being stoned to death by inches and not allowing his flesh in any way to rise up in a resentment or a bitterness against those who are bringing him to that death, but be suffused with a wonderful grace and magnanimity as to ask God their forgiveness with his dying breath? How was he able? Because he saw the heavens opened. Being a man full of the Spirit, he saw the heavens open. And what did he see? Jesus at the right hand of power, which is to say the throne or the place of governmental authority of God over the universe and over creation. And when his detractors heard that, they put their fingers in the ears and ran upon him and gnashed upon him with their teeth. It threw them into a rage. They could not bear to hear that the one whom they thought that they had eliminated through the cross was now by that very thing seated at the right hand of the Father in the place of power of governmental rule. And it says in Luke, when the angel came to Mary, you shall bear a son, his name shall be called Jesus, and he shall rule over the house of Israel forever, and the throne of David shall be given unto him. That the first angelic proclamation is the issue of throne, rule, government. And the government shall be upon his shoulder. Unto us a child is born, a son given. And the government shall be upon his shoulder. And of the increase of that government there shall be no end. The whole issue, saints, is government. But the word has become tainted and corrupted for us. For immediately we think of self-aggrandizement, men stuffing their pockets. We think of a Clinton and every kind of a punk who has used office and releasing men from their crimes at the very end of that office in the ability that a leaving president has to absolve.
Pardon.
What a punk. And so, poo, governor. But the government of God, dear saints, is noble, uplifting.
Amen.
David says it comes down as a dew upon the earth. Mm. It is just and righteous. It is full of equity and mercy. And what are we being prepared for? To replace those fallen, usurping powers of darkness who have misused their governmental role in order to turn the attention of men to themselves as the gods of this world. But we will occupy their vacancies to rule and reign with Christ. The reward of overcoming is rule, but not in some kind of heavy-handed, managerial, self-aggrandizing way, but in the very spirit of the Lamb, to bring the righteousness, the mercy, the wisdom of God, that men should learn how to live in peace with each other as nations. Got the picture? The first martyr saw this, the great martyr Jesus saw it, and we will not be able to bear our martyrdom, which I feel is inevitable and must come to conclude the age, except that we also have the deepest grasp and see by the eye of Spirit Jesus enthroned at the right hand of power, and that the whole issue is his coming as king in that very city and place where he was deprecated and humiliated with the sign in three languages to mock him, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. For if he's not King of the Jews, nor is he King of anyone.
Amen.
And when we shall be dispersed through the nations, God says, I will meet with you in the wilderness of the nations, face to face, and there you will come into the bond of my covenant and unto the rod of my authority. You will come into my rule. So the redeemed of the Lord shall return to Zion with everlasting joy in the heavens. Joy because there will not again be another suffering or an uprooting, but joy also that they have been appointed and elected, then out of their Jerusalem and out of their Zion shall go forth the law of the Lord and the word of the Lord to all nations, that they need not ever again study war any more. I want to pray for that. Thank you, Lord. Oh, precious God. Creative God, we ask, my God, a birthing, an event, something creative, Lord. This isn't a mind trip. We're not going to subscribe to this as a principle. We ask an endowment and something imbued into our gut, into our heart, into the inner man, an eschatological grasp, my God, of what the end is toward which all things are moving, the coming of the King, His kingdom, His rule, His justice, His righteousness in the earth and in the nations, that all, to the ends of the earth, all nations shall bow, shall respect, shall reverence, shall worship the God of Jacob and the God of Abraham. You will have completed your great design with the selection of this one Semite, and bring all the nations under your great rule, that they might also become Semitic. They might also come into your great tent. They might also be tempted, and to live, my God, in a way that befits the God who has created them and given them their nation and the bounds of their habitation. Thank you, Lord. Oh, precious God. Raise us up as the church of the last days that understands, that knows, that can serve sacrificially, that can suffer. Even the absence of the sense of your presence, for whatever reason, that mystery must be experienced by us as it was by the Lord, that we also would cry, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? In the time of our greatest trial, when we most need that comforting assurance and presence, and it'll not be there, what then do we have to sustain us? But the deep inward knowledge that we have all along understood of what the end is.
Yes.
The coming of the King, His rule, His glory over His own earth, over His own creation. Thank you, Lord. Oh, fit us, pray. Fit us, Lord. Precious God, we pray, for the privilege of ruling and reigning with You, to have share in that divine governmental rule, because we have also borne the measure of suffering in obedience to obtain it. We bless You, Lord. Oh, the depths of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, who has been His counselor. We fall before You. We're prostrate, Lord. We're on the donkey.